Subbu. I am going to present the Android security issues. Yeah, you can see the overview of the presentation. First, I will just introduce the framework, then what are the security mechanisms involved in Android, then introduction to web security and some of the attacks which are exist in Android. So today, most of the handheld devices are based upon Android. So today what happens is, the most of the internet users are growing, they are accessing internet with the help of mobiles and tablets. So what they are doing is, they are storing their important data on these devices. So the security became major issues in these devices because there are low computing power and there are low resources like power, etc. So as you know that many of you have discussed the Android framework. So it contains many layers like Android kernel stack, which contains the native libraries, etc. There are runtime, native libraries, application framework, and there is application layer. Yeah. Then coming to security issues, what are the main issues in security?
The OS system should provide the following three requirements:
protect the system resources and application isolation. So to handle these issues, Android has provided many features. Just like it has given it came with a robust OS, like with the help of Linux kernel, it has done the sandboxing of applications. So inter-browser communication between the applications is very secure. And it requires the application signing to be installed, and the permissions which are required by the applications has to be explicitly specified. While going to Android security mechanism, so Android is a multi-processor system. What happens is, whenever an application is installed, it is given with one POSIX user ID. So, if there are two users, one user cannot access the other user resources. So, what happens is, two applications cannot run on same process. So it creates a sandbox. So it also have a provision to use one process resources, that is one application resources, but the other application by using shared user ID feature. So this will also act as vulnerability file system. So Android just implement the Linux file system. So each file will have a three tuples, each with one is each for user group and others. So it will have read, write and execute permissions. So the files which are owned by an application, whatever files it creates, it is owned by the application itself. So the files created by one application cannot be used by other application unless there are explicitly specified. So the one more thing is, the system image is mounted as read mode. So if there is a malicious application which it anyhow gets the chance to access the files, even it can just access, but it cannot change the critical files because the system drive is mounted in read mode. So we can even design attacks such that we can remount the system in read write mode and we can change the critical files. So then Android has many partitions like data partition, system partition, the SD card. So whatever application we install and whatever files the application may create, it entirely goes into data partitions. So there may be some attacks like, if there is a malicious application which creates many number of files, and so it creates lot of files such that the memory go. So in that case, the Android has one facility like, it can, if you boot in safe mode, the data partition is not loaded into RAM. So while there you can check it and we can uninstall this such type of application. Now memory management is an hardware component which facilitates the separation of process of different address spaces. So that means if there is an application, if there is one process cannot access the address spaces of other process. So there are many security issues like, so if the stack is executable, then we can do somehow buffer overflow attack. To avoid that, it has made the stack and heap as non-executable. So to check whether there is a buffer overflow attack or not, we can use propolis, just like a ternary value. We'll just keep an known value at some address space of the stack. As soon as the application is executed, we will check whether that value is changed or not. If it is changed, then we can conclude that is a stack over, that is a buffer overflow. Again, the addresses are allocated randomly. Yeah, then going to type safety. So you know, many programming languages follow type safety, like just like C and not C, just like Java. So what happens is, it should specifically say what data type it has to be. So if it is an integer, we cannot store other values like string or anything in the integer data type. So with the help of this, we can have boundary checking. So this address space belongs to variable A. You should not go beyond this. If this goes, then we can say segmentation for such type of errors. So since Android follows Java, so it is somewhat safe. Even Android allows the applications to have the C components, like native language components. So if you implement in this native components, that is up to the application and or up to the user to install it, because there will be buffer overlap in this. Android follows permission based model. That is, there is application package manager which checks when the application is going to install. It checks whether it has what are permissions it want, and it grants it. The application framework, what it does is it sees whether the application is using the same permissions or not. If it wants some other permissions, it is not granted at the runtime. So there are some built-in permissions like call phone, camera, GPS, etc. All the permissions the application needs should be specified in manifest.xml. Android classifies the permissions into four categories, like normal, which is not more risky, dangerous, which is more risky, and signature, which is rarely used, where two applications came from the same vendor and they want to share the permissions. Now, as you know that applications while installing should request the Android, and Android will ask the user whether to grant or not. If it is granted, then as the application will take only that permissions. It is not allowed to take any extra permissions. Once it is granted, it cannot be revoked until it is uninstalled. Yeah, signing. The application should be signed. So why this signing? Because in manifest.xml, the application may say I required only four permissions. That is very trivial permissions, like just accessing camera, everything. But whereas the application may says that I need some more application permissions. In that case, we can check whether what he claimed is correct or not just by digital signatures. So there will be a certificate in which there is a public key, and the application files are digital signed by the private key. And since we have public key, we can check the signature. While going to injection attacks, you know there are many types of injections, like voice injection, whereas SQL injections, where we embed our code into the SQL queries and tries to execute malicious code. Then there is cross-cut scripting, where the malicious code is executed on the web client web browser. Yeah, while going to cross-cut script, somewhat making kernel to execute some files. So just like buffer overflow attack is a way of scripting. So my malicious code will be stored at some memory, and the return address of the stack and the function call, I will change the return address to the code which I ever kept in the memory. So cross-cut scripting, there are three types of cross-cut scripting. One is persistence, another is non-persistent, which is also called as reflected, another is DOM-based. Whereas in persistent, so for example, there is a web page, that is like a server where there is a vulnerability. So in this, so we will write some malicious code. That script will be stored in the server itself, just like forums. If there is a forum and there is no sanitizing of the inputs, so I can write some script in the forum. So in that forum, the data will be stored there itself. So that is persistent. Whenever the user sees that forum, so that malicious code will also be downloaded and it will be executed in the browser. Whereas in reflected, so the malicious code is not stored in the server, just like if you search in somewhere, like it will reflect, you are showing the results of so and so. If that is not sanitized, so then we reflected across the scripting. Another thing is DOM based, it is a new type of scripting, cross-cut scripting, where so the script runs at the client side itself and the malicious script is kept in the client side itself. Yeah, the precautions for cross-cut scripting can be done at that many stages, like it can be done at server side, it can be done at client side, it can be done at both sides. So while coming to Android, in the web browser which is supporting, they has to do some precautions. Otherwise, it is vulnerable to Kafka scripting. The main effects of Kafka scripting is loss of data. So it's the browser has some stored password. Everything can be sent to the attacker, just like send the cookies, everything. Denial of service. Yeah, the web browser exposes the Android users to common attacks like Kafka scripting. So in the recent attacks, they shows that there are Buffalo attack and Kafka scripting, but that is outdated. They have changed the library. Since the browser has its own user ID and it has some permissions, so even though it is an attack, it is only confined to browser. It cannot access some other files, some other application files. So at most you can get the passwords, form fields and credit card numbers, etc., which is also very dangerous. Yeah, it is even common for every browser. No, even for Google Chrome, it has some mechanisms to work with Kafka scripting, like Mozilla. Every browser has to do something, some mechanisms. No, it's a trade-off between security. If it cannot be followed the standards completely, because for example, if there is a, to avoid Kafka scripting, one good thing we can do is, what is Kafka scripting? We'll send a malicious link to the victim. So the victim, when clicks it goes to the server and comes back to the victim. So the malicious code is sent in the form of parameters. So instead of sending the username, one thing is, Android browser does not download the files which is not supported by Android, just like zip files and RAR files. So how we know that whether the file it is going to download is supported or not? Because with the help of MIME type, you know, in HTTP response, there will be a parameter MIME which tells what type of file it is. If it is a zip file, then it does not download. But even we can even bypass it. Just after all, that MIME type is set by a server, right? So the server may set it as false MIME type, and the Android browser downloads it. Then going to SQL injection. So in the SQL injection, you know, so there will be a front form, and there will be a background. In the background, there will be a SQL query. So if I want to search, you have to get the data from database. That select star from users where name is equal to username. That username will be supplied by the user. So it will be given in the form. So instead of giving the legitimate, genuine name, I may give some SQL query, just like delete table. I'll just close it here by using a quote, and then I can give delete table users. If that was the case, then it can execute it, and it can delete the users table. So this is the introduction to SQL injection. The primary cause for SQL injection is without sanitizing the input, without sanitizing the parameters, it just adds into the query string. So that is manual embedding. That Android supports both manual embedding and automatic embedding. In manual embedding, it just takes the input and just place it here. Whereas in automatic embedding, it's just like placeholders. It just checks for any some meta characters like quoto, everything, and vanishes and removes that one and just place it. If your application is developing based upon automatic embedding, then there is no chance of going for SQL injection. Whereas it is going for manual embedding, there is vulnerable for SQL injection. So then going to resources, the main computing resources. Environment in a computing environment, the main resources are CPU, storage, RAM, and I/O. So while going to CPU, Android follows the Linux completely fair sharing scheduler. That is, it tries to give equal share to all processors. So in some case, there will be some process which required more CPU. Even that is supported, but it does not go for monopolizing the CPU. Whereas going to storage, Linux supports the storage quota. That means this application can use at this time only this amount of space, whereas in Android it is not there. So there may be some malicious application which creates a lot of files, and this takes the entire memory. So this can be done by malicious application. And one provision given in Android is we can see the files application size, how much of size this application takes. So just by seeing that, we can see that, oh, this application is taking so much. So let me uninstall this. But even that can be bypassed. Just so the application even can store files in this private, is not in private folder, we can store it in other folders. If it is, that was the case, the Android does not show that files, that files as in the memory, in the memory occupied by that application. Usually the private folder of the application, it will have some folder, we can usually the applications will create for there itself. So Android what does is, if there is a private folder of application A, then whatever the space occupied that folder, it will be given as the size of the application. But even the application can create files out of this private folder. If that was the case, the files that created outside the private folder is not added to the size of the application. Another thing is, in Linux, when there is RAM is very less and that is more number of application processors coming, then it kills some processes. So even in Android, this is implemented very, very aggressively, just like ROM memory killer. What happens is, if there are 10 processes in the RAM and RAM is going out of memory, then it kills the least recently used application. Least recently used application. So what happens is, if the least recently application may be used only some memory, still I kill that one. Whereas the most recently used, you take more memory, I am not killing that. By killing the big application, I may accommodate more number of processes. So that has to be changed in Android. That is the problem, right? If I'm blindly deleting the processor which is least recently used, so which takes only 5 MB. Let me say that 5 MB. Yeah, LRU policy. For the least recently used, just it may take 100 MB. If I delete that process, if I kill that processes, then I may accommodate more number of processes. Whereas if killing a least recently used, which is low, which take low memory, then it may be a problem. Coming to some basic attacks, just zero application attack, zero permission application. So what is zero permissions? That means the application don't have any permissions. It is not specified any permissions in the manifest.xml. The package manager in the Android does not give any permissions to it. Still it can do some things in Android. So the things which it can do is, it can read the sdcard. So sdcard, any files written on the sdcard can be read by this application. Another thing it can do is, it can list all the applications which are already installed on this Android. It can get the what this SIM vendor and GSM ID and Android ID and kernel version. So one thing is, if you got this data, what you can do? After all, it is a zero permission application. You just get a data, where to send? You don't have any internet connection, you don't have anything to send. With no permissions, literally there won't be any permission. No, that is the Android flaw. They can read files on the sdcard. They can list all the application which is present in it. So what can we do with this data? Yes, we can do it. Because with action view intent in the browser, we can open the browser. Without any permissions, we can open the browser by just calling that action view. Once I open the browser, I can send in the get parameters into the attacker website. So then what is the Google response on it? When they asked what about the why we are able to read files on the SD card, then they said that yeah, it was been there, but it has kept as the application terms of use. That means any application can read files on the SD card, but it should not read as terms of use, you should not read. But it may be a genuine danger because there may be some third party application. Then going to list of application, then he said it is a provision. It's an option given to the user to application to view what are applications are installed. They said it is a user ways to get the list of application installed. But it is a genuine danger because by knowing the what are application installed on the Android, I may see that, oh, this application installed on Android. So this Android device may be vulnerable to so-and-so attack. If so, if an application X is installed in the Android, then I can see, oh, X is installed. So I can target this Android device with so-and-so attack. So even this is a danger. Then when going to, so since it can get the mobile code and the network, etc., then the Google said that it's very trivial information. With the help of this information, we cannot get anything, and it is not possible for any attacks. One precaution is don't store any information on SD card, personal information, because it is a provision given by Android. We cannot change that provision that any application can blindly read the data on SD card. But it is violating the terms of use. That is apart. Another thing is, so if there is an application which writes some important data on the SD card, so later after knowing, the developers may patch that patch it and give us an update. So one should be install all the updates as it arrives. No exploits on images. Another thing is, so you know, in Android the images don't, the other portion of the writes, it has read permission. So the images has read permissions. Anyone can read any images in the Android device. So my application can read any images in the Android. So I will design a malicious application which reads all the photos and send to me. This was the one. Then Google said that yeah, we are working on it, and most probably in the next version we may add that it. Then they said, oh, photo accessing as a design choice. This is shared certificate exploit. That means two applications came from the same vendor. Then with the help of shared user ID feature, they can share the permissions. So for example, if there is one application which has internet access, which comes from one vendor A, it is installed onto the Android. In later, the same vendor A has given some other application which can access contents. So when these two applications has been installed onto the Android and they have shared user ID feature, then one application can read the contents and another application can send the internet, the same contents with the help of internet. So it is a subset, it is a superset of the permissions of two individual applications. So one should be careful while installing applications from same vendor. So while we are installing an application from the same vendor, we should see whether some danger portion of the permissions are, it is whether it has asked. If that was the case, that is better not going for that application. Another thing is reverse engineering. So since Android applications are developed based upon Java, in Java we know that class files can be converted into Java files. So the logic behind the serial code can be traced off. And once it has been traced off, then we can do the same logic and we can crack the licensing. So to prevent this, what we can do is, see that Android has, the components of an Android application even can be developed with the help of native C components. So since reverse engineering is difficult in such type of languages, so we will do the licensing model, only the licensing model in that native C component. So the reverse engineering is not possible. Yeah, one is a conceptual flaw in Android sandbox. What is, the Android is well structured in permissions, but there is no transitive permissions. It does not track the transitive permissions. So I will come into the next slide. So this results in performing actions that Android sandbox is not authorized to do. So an application which is not authorized to do something, even it can do it because of this fundamental flaw. I will explain it. That is privilege. The same thing is privilege escalation attack. That means at the installation of the application, there will be only few permissions. While running it, it may escalate its permissions. That is privilege escalation attack. So it may range from phone calls, text messages, and illegal downloads, etc. So what is the flaw? See, application with less privileges is not restricted to access the components of more privileged application. So this was the problem in the Android. So if there is an application A whose components has very less privilege than components in B, still it can access that components. In Android, we can share the components. Explicitly, we can share the components. The Android has a provision. So what it says is, these permissions, though, so what Android says is, so it can access, but before accessing, you should have some some privilege level. So the component, the application component which has this privilege level can only access this. So this is specified in manifest.xml. But after that, application is developed by a developer who is may not be aware of security. If I am developing an application, if I don't want that component to be used by so and so, the application with so and so privileges, then I have to explicitly say it. So this application component can only be accessed by a component with such privileges. So for example, if you take, there are three applications A, B, C. There are three applications A, B, C, and if A has two components like CA1 and CA2 and B, and I have no permissions, no granted permissions, whereas B has permission P1 and consists of components CB1 and CB2. So neither of the CB1 and CB2 is not protected by permission label. That means the application developed B has not said anything that the component CB1 is accessed by so and so. So there is no restriction, anyone can access the component in CB1. If the application does not want this component to be used, then the developer has to explicitly say in manifest.xml. So CB1 and CB are not protected by permission labels. So CB1 and CB1 can access the component which is protected by P1, because CB1 and CB2 are the components of application B. B has a permission to access P1. So the components in application B can access any components which is protected by permission label P1. For example, C has no permissions and consisting of components CC1 and CC2. The developer of application C, what he says is, my component CC1 can be only accessed by an application whose permission is P1. That is, it is protected by permission label. Whereas in the same way, C2 with protected by the permission label P2. See, there is an application here, right? So that contains two components, CA1 and CA2. It has no permissions. There is application B, which is granted with permission P1. And there is a component CB1, CB2. It has not protected by any permissions, any permission labels. So there is application C. It has no granted permissions. And it has two components. So any components in this application can access the any components which has protected label P1. Yeah, B can access C because it is protected by label P1, and this application has granted permission P1. Application will be granted permission and components will be have a permission label. That means this component can be used by so and so applications. So that means this is protected by P1, means this component can be only used by an application components whose has P1 permissions granted. No, see, it cannot access C1 is there, right? So it cannot access it directly. Because CA1 has protected label P1. CC1 has protected label P1. So what it says, the components of an application who want to access this component has to be granted with P1. So A cannot access this, but B has granted P1, right? So it can access this. So A can access B because it has not protected with permission labels. It is a mistake of a developer. He would have kept it as a P1 protected. Then this may not be happened. So you should know, right? So the less privileged system should not access me. So my application is accessing P1. My application is accessing P1. If I don't give any permission labels to this, then any application can access my component. So you do have keeping P1, then you may not be using. So to protect this, what has to be, B has to be additional checks on the permission B. There should be some additional checks that C1 should be granted only to the application who has permission P1. But it is left to the application developer. So there are many number of applications without implementing this, and there are so because of this there are many security flaws in the applications. Even some of the applications survey says that some of the applications which are developed by Google itself is vulnerable to these type of attacks. So now we are coming with many advanced frameworks which even track this. It's a collision attack. The same thing which it comes from the same vendor, and where there are two applications coming from the same vendor, and they have same digital signature. No, they have same certificate, and if they have shared secret key, then one application can use the other application resources. Just like so, one application has permission to record audio and monitor the call activity, whereas the second application from has internet permissions. So one application can record this call, another application can send it. So these are the differences. Thank you.